Program. I'm your host, Betsy Rosenberg, and we do have a jam-packed program today. Up next, very pleased to introduce Shanna Devine. She is an investigator and legislative campaign coordinator with the Government Accountability Project, otherwise known as GAP, and they have just done an investigation of the long-term impacts, well, long-term meaning 3 years out from the BP oil disaster and that horrible fire that took 11 lives. Turns out there's some health impacts as well as the obvious environmental impacts and problems that we're just now really beginning to fully understand. So, Shanna, thanks for joining us.
Hi, Betsy. Thanks for having me.
You started looking at this when? Has this been going on steadily since the disaster 3 years ago, or was this more recently begun?
Our investigation began 20 months ago in 2011 after we were approached by a physician based in Louisiana who was actually treating workers and residents made sick by the spill. We've subsequently decided to conduct an investigation into what we've found to be widespread health problems associated with not only the oil, but exposure to Corexit, the dispersant that was used to allegedly clean up the oil spill. Our findings found that, in fact, the use of Corexit may have been more destructive to human health and the environment than the spill itself. And that's of significant concern now because this type of dispersant continues to be used in the Gulf, or it's approved by the EPA to continue to be used, and that raises real concerns with us.
How long have dispersants been used? I'm asking specifically in relation to the Exxon Valdez spill. I remember Dr. Ricky Ott, who's been on my show over the years several times, you know, did some long-term studies of the fishermen who were impacted not only for their industry, their work, but also their health. And they were definitely health impacts. And I'm wondering if that was tied to dispersants or just the oil. Do you happen to know how long dispersants like Corexit have been in use?
Corexit was, I know it was used in the 70s on a larger oil spill in Mexico, and it was certainly used in the Exxon Valdez spill. In fact, had the opportunity to work with Ricky, and she was warned, she was in the Gulf warning folks that the same dispersant used in Exxon Valdez that was later linked to health problems with cleanup workers was being used in the Gulf. Subsequently, BP's own medical monitoring actually found chemicals in 20% of offshore workers, a chemical known as 2-butoxyethanol, which is a possible human carcinogen, was linked to health problems by workers in Exxon Valdez and also linked to health problems by workers in the Gulf. So this is a problem that we've known about for some time, at least since the 80s, and continue to use to date.
Do you think that was, you know, Dr. Ott's work in particular was ignored by the government? Never reached that level? You know, what's the point of having this kind of research that's very compelling if it just gets ignored?
It's a great question. We were scratching our heads after going through research on the extensive health problems that have been documented and environmental problems from earlier usage, why it continued to be approved to date. We found that it's in part due to the EPA's rather dated dispersant policy that doesn't require it to evaluate the human health or environmental impacts of a dispersant before it is used, and that largely comprised Ricky's research and GAP subsequently. A big goal of ours now is to update dispersant policies so that we're not faced with the same problem.
So who are you seeing the health impacts, you know, affecting most?
By far, the workers who are on the front lines of the cleanup, exposed to the Corexit as it was sprayed, as they cleaned up the dispersed oil, they had the most immediate health impacts. But our investigation and, in fact, earlier work by the Louisiana Environmental Action Network, a nonprofit organization based in Louisiana that we teamed up with to conduct our investigation, they documented and we worked with whistleblowers who were residents as well as workers impacted by the spill and have had severe health impacts to date. In some cases, even tourists who maybe swam in the Gulf beaches after they were open shortly after the spill, or consumed Gulf seafood that may have been tainted, have had similar health impacts. And it's what's most concerning and reported by the physician we've been working with, Dr. Michael Robichaud, is that the health problems were similar across the Gulf. So he'd be seeing patients from Florida, Mississippi, Alabama, and Louisiana, who had all swam in different beaches, but beaches across the Gulf, and were coming to him with the exact same health problems. I'd be glad to go through a few. They're really horrifying, and they continue to experience these problems to date.
Yes, please go ahead.
Just to name a few: blood and urine, heart palpitations, hyperallergic reactions to any processed food or petroleum-based products such as a plastic water bottle, hypertension, inability to withstand exposure to the sun, both kidney and liver damage, migraines, neurological damage resulting in memory loss, and in some cases documented IQ drops. Rapid weight loss, 30 to 40 pounds within several months, in particular for workers during the cleanup. Respiratory problems, nervous system damage, seizures, temporary paralysis, violent vomiting episodes. The list really goes on. But you can imagine how startling that is. And it's not isolated to, again, workers and residents. It's the kids that are being impacted, those who have lower immune systems and are more susceptible to even limited chemical exposure, or experiencing some of the most serious impacts.
I remember seeing a screening of the documentary The Big Fix, and the producers who worked on that, I think it was Rebecca Tickell and her husband, remembering her specifically because she... Josh is her husband, if I'm remembering correctly. I see a lot of green
That's
films.
Correct.
But what struck me was she talked about how ill she got. She was in the water when they were doing the filming. I can't remember exactly why she would be in it, maybe to get part of the story, I suspect. And she got so ill that they said she might not be able to get pregnant as a result. And this is a young woman, and I was devastated to hear that. I can only imagine, you know, what she feels.
Thank you for raising that. They did a really magnificent job with that film, and I hope it continues to get the coverage it deserves. But it raises concerns by our witnesses about the long-term health effects associated with exposure, from reproductive damage, which we're already beginning to see, to cancer down the road. In fact, Earth Justice came out with a report once the ingredients in the dispersant Corexit that were made public that found five of the ingredients are carcinogenic, which raised huge red flags throughout the Gulf, as you can imagine.
So what are you recommending? What is the report going to suggest be done?
Absolutely. That's one of our main goals coming out of this is probably the first priority is treatment for those made sick by the spill. The National Institute of Environmental Health and Sciences, a government agency, is conducting a long-term study to track the health problems by workers and volunteers on the cleanup. That study does not, there's no treatment component to their study, and that's a concern for us. So that's indeed the first priority. From there is dispersant reform, so we don't continue to encounter or be faced with the same problems during a future oil spill. There are some common sense reforms that we're calling for that have been already introduced by Congressman Nadler of New York, and and Senator Lautenberg of New Jersey in the 111th Congress when this bill took place that would require the EPA to test for human health and environmental impacts before dispersant is approved. But now their bill actually goes so far as to call for a ban on all chemical dispersants until their safety is ensured, and we'll be lobbying for those reforms this Congress. Immediately, the EPA can take measures to reform its dispersant policy until Congress passes legislation, which can be a lengthy process, and we'll be meeting with them on that subject as well.
Is it GAP's position, Shauna, that it would have been better off to not use a dispersant? It made it look less, awful, because it made some of the oil slick less visible. But was that just, for BP's PR benefit? Or as far as environmental impacts, knowing what's now known, would it have been better to use another dispersant, no dispersant? Or did this really help protect the environment but cause health problems?
It's a great question, and for a broader overview of the use of dispersant, the EPA did argue that there was an environmental trade-off to use it, and it was, in order to fight the oil offshore so that it wouldn't hit the shorelines, there would invariably be effects to marine life, but that it would be a lesser environmental impact than if dispersant wasn't used. And we've found through our investigation and working with LEAN and others on the ground that the environmental impact was absolutely exacerbated by the use of dispersant. It became the oil became 52 times more toxic when mixed with Corexit. While it was fought offshore and did help prevent it from hitting the shorelines, it then dispersed throughout the environment, so it was much more difficult to contain. A lot of the oil, the dispersed oil, either settled on the seafloor or penetrated the water column, so it was out of sight. We could no longer see it on the surface, but shortly after, in fact, you may recall, I think it was in July 2010, after the well was capped, the administration came out and said, the head of NOAA, 70% of the oil is gone. It's naturally biodegraded, and ultimately had to come back and recant, take back that statement, because they found extensive underwater plumes demonstrating the oil was not gone. It just was now out of sight. And we're finding it's still hitting the shorelines. It's either in the wetlands, in the marshes, or after major storms, the oil that's dormant on the seafloor is slowly washing up. And that's absolutely a huge concern. Oh, I'm sorry.
I'm here, Shauna, but we do have to wrap up. So if people would like to read more, and I encourage them to, where can they go?
Thank you. Please, www.whistleblower.org/GulfTruth. Or they can go to the Louisiana Environmental Action Network's website. They've been working closely with us as well to learn more.
Shauna Devine, I thank you so much for your work, and also for the work at GAP, the Government Accountability Project, protecting corporate, government, and international whistleblowers since 1977. Still needed more than ever, it seems. And anyone who heard this interview cannot watch those BP ads any longer without saying, not quite all beautiful and fixed and ready for tourism. So thank you for shedding light on this. Sorry to hear that that's exactly what's happening. Sometimes our environmentalist worst fears get overblown or we're exaggerating, and sometimes they get confirmed. In this case, confirmed. And I thank you for putting the science behind that hunch, and continue the good work.